From the web services introduction video, you know that many ServiceNow integrations require communicating with third-party systems, and that you can configure your instance to consume third-party web services through the Outbound SOAP message and REST message modules. This video covers the REST message module. Click an item to go directly to that topic. Otherwise, we'll cover all topics. ServiceNow Outbound REST functionality allows you to make requests to HTTP endpoints, for example, Google Contacts API or REST APIs on another ServiceNow instance. For the purposes of this demonstration, we'll use a ServiceNow instance as the target web server. So here we have two ServiceNow instances open. One is the consumer, from which we'll make HTTP requests to the target instance by using REST message functionality. We're logged into both the consumer and target instances with the web service admin role, which is required to access the system web services modules. Here, we also need the REST service role. You should be familiar with the REST API and the parameters it accepts before attempting to define a REST message in a ServiceNow instance. Here's our target instance. We'll start by using the REST API Explorer, which accesses information on this instance, providing endpoint, methods, and query parameters that we can use to build and send a REST web service request from our consumer instance. The REST API Explorer allows us to quickly build and execute sample requests. We can then reference this sample when we're configuring our REST message. We'll use the GET method to retrieve records from a table. Here's the URL to be used in the endpoint. The request and response will both be formatted as JSON, which is the default for the ServiceNow system. This is fine for now. The request can be sent as the logged-in user or as another user. If we select Send as another user, we need to provide the username and password. We're going to make a GET request against the incident table, so we must have a role which allows us to view that table. Here's where we indicate which parameters to request. Let's get just the SysParm field number. That'll give us the incident number. If we don't include this parameter in our request, we'll receive all fields in the response. The SysParm limit is set to give us up to 10 records, which is fine. Now we send our request. Here's what went out in the request, the HTTP method URI and headers, application JSON. And here's what we got back as a response, status code 200 OK, the headers, and in the response body, 10 incident numbers. Now let's look at how we would make this same request from the consumer instance using a REST message. We'll start by copying the URL, which we'll need for the endpoint of the request. The information needed to send REST requests is stored in REST message records. We'll create a new one. Let's call it Table API Consumer because we'll use it to consume the REST Table API on the ServiceNow target instance. We paste that copied URL here and replace table name with the actual name of the table we'll use, Incident. Relocking the field prevents accidental changes. We'll use basic authentication, so here we enter the ID and password for a user who is authorized to make requests to the API and view records in the underlying table on our target instance. The platform automatically generates HTTP method records for post, get, put, and delete. These perform the requests that create, retrieve, update, or delete data at the endpoint with a REST message. We'll use the GET method. These methods inherit some fields from the parent record, for example, endpoint and authentication. Any changes we make here will override those at the parent message level. Mutual authentication allows a client and server to establish trust by exchanging and validating each other's SSL certificates. If your REST web service can only be reached via a mid-server, you can configure your REST messages to be sent through a mid-server. To do this, specify the mid-server you'd like to send REST messages through. For this functionality to work, there must be a running mid-server associated with your ServiceNow instance. Also, note that mutual authentication is not available when making outbound web service calls through a mid-server. We don't need a mid-server for this demo. For HTTP query parameters, let's use the same ones we used in the REST API Explorer on the target instance. We can just copy them from here and paste them here. The field we want is number. Let's copy and paste the sysparm limit too. This time, we'll just ask for 5 results. After we save it, we can use this UI action to test it. And here are the results. HTTP status is 200, OK. Here's the endpoint where the request was made on the incident table of our target instance. Here are the query parameters. We asked for the number field with a limit of 5 records. And we got back exactly what we requested, so our GET method works. But suppose we wanted to get XML back instead of the default JSON. We would specify that here in the HTTP headers list. To figure out the correct format, we go back to the REST API Explorer. If we change the response format to XML and send the request accept header is specified here, accept application / XML. So let's go back and put that in the HTTP headers list in our REST message GET method. The name is accept and the value is application / XML. Now we save it and test it, and we see that our response is in XML. We can compare this to the response in the previous test, which was JSON. Now let's look at variable substitution, which allows you to take typically static content and make it dynamic by defining variables and mapping values to them through the scripting API. Here's the format for variable substitution. Suppose we wanted to use a variable for the number of records returned, the sysparm limit. We could do that by substituting a variable here in place of the value. Now we need to define that variable in the variable substitutions list. And when we test it, our value 1 is substituted for var1, and we get only 1 record back. Variable substitution can be used in REST query parameters, and also in headers and endpoints, as well as in the content field for post and put methods. While it is possible to include query parameters in the endpoint, the best practice is to define them in the HTTP query parameters list, where they can be viewed easily. Now let's look at a post method, which is used to create a record. Unlike the GET method, post and put methods require content. Again, we'll use the REST API Explorer to help us format the method, making our request on the incident table. We'll send a short description for the incident, need access to sales database, and give it an urgency of 1. When we send it, we get this reminder that we'll be modifying data if we confirm. Here's our request and the response. Let's make a mental note that the headers are accept application JSON and content type application JSON. Now if we copy the request body, we can paste it into the content field of the post method back in our consumer instance. And let's add those headers here, one for content type because this method does have content and one for accept. We don't need any query parameters. Now we save it and test it. And we get back an HTTP status of 201, so the record was created. Variable substitution works in the content field as well. Let's create a new variable substitution for urgency with a test value of 2. And replace the value 1 in the content field with the variable substitution value. When we test it, we see that the urgency in the content field was 2 this time. Clicking this Preview Script Usage link displays the script used to call that REST message. Note that you can use the setStringParameter functions to override the values of variable substitutions at runtime. We can copy this script to use from any scripting level in the platform, that is, any place that can run a server-side script. Here are a few examples of where these scripts can be used. Business rules, script includes, script actions, or even background scripts. The response body provides the response we saw when we tested this method. And this is how we get the HTTP status code to validate the request. Finally, the script uses the REST message V2 API. The product documentation covers its available functionality. One thing to point out here is the difference between execute and execute async. When using execute, the instance waits for a response from the web service provider. When using execute async, the instance does not wait for a response before moving on in the script. Note that if the response, REST response v2, object returned by calling execute async is referenced later in the script, it will cause the instance to wait for a response, and the response can be accessed through the REST response object. For more information, please consult our product documentation or knowledge base, or ask a question in the ServiceNow community.